Okay, looks like we're ready to go, folks. Welcome to the Plan Commission meeting for January 17th, 2017. For those that have not had the pleasure of attending one of our meetings before, the way things work is once we call the roll and approve the minutes from the last meeting, when we get to the first item, city staff presents on the item. Once they're done making their presentation, it's opened up just to the commission for technical questions and sometimes other things. And after technical questions are done, it's opened up to the public. If you have something to say about an item, please step up to the microphone over there, state your name and address so we know who you are and where you live for the minutes. And you may get a question or two from the commission. Once everybody who has wanted to speak has had the opportunity to do so, we close public commentary, bring it back to the commission for discussion and usually a vote. With that, let us call the roll, Deb.
David Borsak.
Present.
Ed Bowen. Jeffrey Tomes.
Here.
Thomas Kortek.
Here.
John Hintz.
Here.
Steve Cummings.
Here.
Kathleen Kropp.
Here.
John Kiefer.
Here.
Robert Weigert.
Here.
Carl Nolenberger.
All right, now moving on to the approval of minutes from the last meeting of January 3rd. Do we have any additions, corrections, deletions, etc.?
Move to approve.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Clearly passes. Let's move on to item number one, which we've seen before. Residential design standards variance request for the closure of six windows on the front and side elevation of property located at 15 West 11th Avenue.
Chairman. All right, so this item was before the Plan Commission at our last meeting, so I'll just kind of quickly run through the background for you. The property is a residential lot located on West 11th Avenue, just west of South Main Street. The lot contains a two-story, two-family residential structure, which was built in 1920. The surrounding area contains predominantly single and two-family uses with commercial abutting South Main Street. And the property is zoned CMU with a planned development overlay, so Central Mixed-Use District. Here is a look at the existing conditions. The applicant is proposing to reduce the number of windows on the front and side facade. They are looking to reduce from 15 porch windows, which are approximately 24 inches by 66 inches in size each, to a total of 9 windows, which are approximately 30 inches by 60 inches in size each. See on the screen, this was the original proposal of what the applicant was looking to do. So two sets on the left and right elevation, or east and west, and then a total of four or two sets of windows on the front elevation. So at the last meeting, it was recommended that staff go back and work with the applicant to look at something that would be a balance between the intent of the residential design standards and what the objectives of the property owner are. They're really looking at security and safety of the property, energy efficiency, and just looking to update it in general and provide some more storage for their tenants. So staff work with the contractor, and really from our perspective, the front or north-facing elevation was the biggest concern. They were just reducing too many windows from what was there currently. So the contractor has provided an alternative where they would install five new windows across the front elevation. They would be distributed equally amongst the front, which will help to kind of provide that look of an open air porch. And it also will allow the applicant or the property owner to improve his property and add additional security. Staff felt that this was a good balance, like I said, between the intent of the design standards. It did add additional cost to the overall project. Originally, the project was approximately $4,600. The additional window did add $500 additional to the project, so overall, the project is $5,100. So with that, and I'd be happy to answer any technical questions, staff is recommending approval of the variance request to permit the reduction of windows, with the following finding: that the standards do not apply to this particular project because the proposed window reductions will not adversely impact the neighborhood and the structure's architectural integrity.
Okay, thank you. Technical questions? Once, twice. Okay, none. Anybody here from the public to speak to this item today? Commissioner's not here. Okay, public commentary is closed. Back to the commission.
Move to approve.
Second.
Question from Kathy?
I think this is a nice compromise.
I would agree.
Fine.
Any other discussion or questions about the motion? All right, call the roll.
Weigert?
Aye.
Borsak?
Aye.
Holmes?
Aye.
Hints?
Aye.
Cummings?
Aye.
Crop?
Aye.
Kiefer?
Aye.
Woytek?
Aye.
Motion carried, 8-0.
Okay, moving on, item number two, planned development review for development of a mixed-use arena slash event complex located at 1212 South Main.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So the subject site is approximately 8.05 acres, and it includes the former location of the Buckstaff Company between South Main Street and East South Park Avenue and East 11th Avenue. The surrounding area contains a mix of industrial, commercial, and residential uses, including Alroy Steel and Calmerton Welding Supplies to the north, Railroad Right-of-Way and the Pioneer Marina to the east, Davis Painting to the south, and commercial and residential uses to the west across South Main Street. The petitioner is proposing to develop a 3,500-seat mixed-use arena on the subject site, which would also include or house a 157-seat sports bar and team store open to the public on non-event days. The proposed use is consistent with the city's comprehensive land use plan, as the area is identified as appropriate for mixed-use downtown development. And it is also consistent or is a permitted use within the central mixed-use zoning district. Approval of the proposed development plan will meet the requirements of the city's planned development overlay district and is intended to satisfy the requirements of the general and specific implementation plan. During events, there would be between 30 and 40 staff members employed to service the venue. On game days, there would be approximately 40 players, six coaches, and four game officials. And during the off season, the facility may also be used for other events, including concerts. The arena would be approximately 6,200 square feet in size and would accommodate, like I said, 3,500 event attendees. Other improvements include a service and loading area, mechanical and refuse enclosure, surface parking lot, and a total of six access drive, which lead from all three street frontages. The building is proposed to be located on the southern portion of the development site, with the primary facade and entrance facing South Main Street. And the surface parking lot area is proposed on the northern half of the site with primary access from East 11th Avenue. Proposed placement of improvements will require two base standard modifications. The first modification is to permit placement of the refuse enclosure, which is located in the front yard along East South Park Avenue. The second modification is to permit placement of the service and loading facility also located in the front yard of East South Park Avenue. Staff feels the petitioner has been sensitive with the design of these improvements. For example, the proposed enclosures will match the materials of the building, which should minimize the impacts of the refuse and mechanical enclosure placement. And additionally, the service and loading area is partially obstructed by the building's projection along East South Park Avenue and proposed site landscaping. Vehicular access to the site, I'm going to stay on this one here because it's a little bit easier to see. Will be accomplished, like you said, by a total of six access drives and one service and loading area. There are three access drives proposed along East South or 11th Avenue. Sorry, the mouse is a little jerky here. So we've got one, two, and three. The first two access points would be gated with a 8-foot tall gate, and the third access would be the primary event day access point for those visiting the venue. Then you have another primary access point off of South Street here. The south entrance will serve as the main entry for non-event days and primarily permit access to the site. It will be gated during events and limited for access to and from on event days. And then you also have two additional access points here on South Park Avenue. The first is primarily intended for employees and will be gated during events. And then you'll have the sixth access point here on East South Park Avenue, which will serve as a VIP entrance and event day access point. Base standard modification to permit an 8-foot-tall gate for all proposed gated access drives, whereas a 4-foot is permitted by code in the front yard, will be required. So these two will be gated. This entry on South Main will be gated. And then this final access point on East South Park Ave will be gated as well. In addition to the base standard modification for the gate height, four base standard modifications to the access control ordinance are required for the development. The first is to permit three street accesses along East 11th Avenue and two street accesses along East South Park Avenue. And as the access control ordinance limits properties with less than 600 feet of frontage to one. The second is to permit reduced lateral clearance from all access drives as proposed, where the access control ordinance requires a minimum of 75 feet of lateral clearance. The third access control variance is to permit backing and maneuvering within the right-of-way to allow truck traffic to utilize the proposed service and loading area and refuse enclosure. And the fourth is to permit a 36-foot wide access drive on East 11th Avenue, the easternmost drive, where the access control ordinance limits the width to 30 feet. Staff is supportive of the proposed base standard modifications, but given the potential traffic generation associated from the proposed use, staff is recommending that a traffic impact analysis be completed and submitted to the city for review. All right, I'm gonna get into a little bit more of the actual building itself. In terms of landscaping, a minimum of 340 points must be achieved through a combination of plantings located near the building's foundation within paved areas and street frontages and open areas. The proposed plan as submitted achieves a total of 6,317 points, so more than doubling what is required by code, through a combination of trees and shrubs. A preliminary landscape plan has been submitted, but a formal one will be included and reviewed as part of the site plan review process. And you can see on the screen, this is the preliminary landscape plan. Let's see, next one here. Lighting. The preliminary lighting and photometric plans have been included with the application material. The applicant is proposing to install 30-foot-tall light fixtures throughout the surface parking lot area and near the building entrances. The proposed lighting fixture height will require a base standard modification to permit a 10-foot increase in the code-permitted 20-foot height allowance for the lighting fixtures. Staff is supportive of the proposed base standard modification because it will ensure pedestrian safety and mitigate conflicts between the proposed trees within the landscape islands. Submitted plans also show light spillover exceeding code requirements at the property line. Staff is unable to comment at this time because formal photometric plans have not been completed. So when analyzed at the site plan review process, if lighting is shown to exceed the maximum limits, the petitioner will need to apply for an amendment to the plan development or devise an alternative solution. Additionally, staff is recommending that the final lighting fixtures specifications be reviewed and approved by the Department of Community Development to mitigate any potential conflicts with the adjacent land uses across South Main Street. In terms of signage, conceptual signage plans have been included with a submitted or with a submittal and include wall-mounted signs on each entry and a monument and ground sign located on the corner of South Park Avenue, which I think you can see right there. Staff is recommending that a formal signage plan be submitted and required to be brought back through the Plan Commission and Common Council for approval in order to mitigate, again, any potential negative conflicts with the adjacent land uses. Stormwater management for the site. Formal plans have not been included with the application materials and will need to be reviewed by the Department of Public Works for approval. However, proposed plans do depict the use of pervious pavers within the surface parking lot and internal pedestrian walkway areas. Preliminary comments from the Department of Public Works state that the development will need to meet the city's stormwater quality control and quantity control requirements for a redevelopment site. All right, and then lastly here, the proposed building is designed with approximately 16-foot entries running along the north and west side with the event day entrance vestibules on the west side facing South Main Street and the VIP or bar entrance on the north facade facing 11th Avenue. The arena has a maximum overall height of approximately 38 feet at the peak of the roofline. The exterior building materials are proposed to be a combination of brick veneer, a decorative block veneer, and colored architectural metal panels. The submitted renderings propose to break up wall massing through a combination of use of materials and windows and include large bands of architectural metal panels, building articulation, and decorative parapet walls near building entrances. The submitted building renderings also show proposed material colors. However, the applicant has stated that final color schemes may be changed depending on sponsorships. And I also just need to quickly hit on the parking for the site itself. The CMU Central Mixed Use District does not require on-site parking. However, the proposed development plan does depict a total of 580 surface parking stalls located on the northern portion of the subject site. Additionally, staff has conducted an analysis of available on-street parking in the area and found that there are approximately 753 on-street parking spaces available between West 8th Avenue on the north, South Main Street on the east, West 16th Avenue on the south, and Oregon Street on the west. It include in the PowerPoint here a picture all the way at the end of the on-street parking availability. The areas in green are unrestricted. Areas in red are no parking. Yellow is 2-hour limit, and the blue is a 4-hour limit. I do want to note, though, that this analysis does not include any off-street parking lots in the area, which may also be available for potential parking needs. So with that, staff is recommending approval of the development plan as proposed with the conditions that were included within your packet. Did you want me to quickly run through those for you?
Any highlights of those?
Predominantly base standard modifications required for the placement of the refuse enclosure and the service and loading located both on East South Park Ave. You'll also need a base standard modification for the 8-foot gates in the front yard. Access control base standard modifications include 3 street accesses along East 11th and South Park Avenue, and it'll also be required for the reduced lateral clearance and to permit backing and maneuvering within the right-of-way. Additionally, the easternmost access along East 11th will require, because it is wider than the 30-foot permitted width by the access ordinance. Final gate specifications, we are looking for those to be approved by the Department of Community Development. Traffic impact analysis will be required. Cross-access will be required between the railroad property to permit access to the easternmost drive on South Park Avenue. And then fixed in-place wheel stops or grade separation be required for parking stalls within the pedestrian walkways shown between double parking stalls. And then formal signage plans be required to be brought back by the Department of Public Works.
Lovely.
Sorry. Yeah.
Thank you. Yep. Tactical questions. Who wants to start? Jeff.
A few things. How many parking stalls did you say was going to be planned in the parking?
580. 80.
And how many would be required for a 3,500-foot person stadium?
Parking code requires one parking stall per 5 seats for a similar use in a different district.
So they're well under the requirement.
If you're in a different zoning district,
right.
In the central district. Historically, we don't have, because we typically in the central area, we don't have enough land to provide for parking. Most of the uses in the central district do not require any type of parking.
Did the police and fire comment on the use of the street parking when it would be that kind of capacity? I mean, this is something for the common council to consider, because you're going to probably get blowback from the residents with as many people parking in front of their homes and not being able to use that parking themselves. I know we had that in Ripon with Alliance, and that got very controversial. I mean, you're gonna get that. So, I mean, because there's not enough parking to house if they got full attendance.
Correct. I mean, I think if you look at the parking situation, you look at the area, like I said, does have capacity, and you're looking really at a limited amount of events per year. This is not a daily.
No, and I understand.
25, for at least for the basketball end, I think it was 25 home games a year. So we figured based on, I think the NBA uses, we're talking with the developer, and we'll bring him out there in a little bit. I think they count on 3.5 people per car. That's their statistic for parking. So I think we looked at the capacity, and I think we needed another 300 spots out mm-hmm. in the neighborhood. That's when we started looking at, yeah, there'll be some people are going to be parking on the street in legal parking spaces for a limited duration of time.
I look at this as obviously it's an attraction for the downtown area, and we've talked about before having these big large open parking lots and visibility. I'm kind of surprised that there wasn't more from the staff standpoint as far as making them develop something that hides that more from Main Street. I know there's landscaping there, but that, yeah, a buffer, like, you know, some kind of berm that could, or something that makes that a little bit higher, and then they plant the trees and stuff so that the visibility, as long as, you know, there's not a safety issue about pulling out, that the visibility, that we hide that parking lot more because of that Main Street is a main artery coming into the city. I'm not too concerned about how the rest of the aesthetics are going to look, because I think will be attractive, but I was concerned about that issue, and the fencing issue that not be chain link. Again, because of the aesthetic value, like we did over in the Central Guards, we said no, and they came up with a much mm-hmm. a nicer look. Same thing with berming over at the Central Guards, it was used to hide some of the less attractive things that made that whole process more attractive. So I was a little bit concerned about that. The other issue is I see like zero for stormwater issues, other than they're looking at maybe using some impervious pavers in the parking area. That doesn't necessarily solve the particulate issue, may solve some of the water runoff issue, and we put the caveat on there that it has to be approved, but I don't know if that's going to alter some of the development if they have to put in some kind of water retention or not. Did anybody
We'll bring Steve up here to talk a little bit about that in a minute.
Okay.
It's a challenging site just because you've got high groundwater conditions over here, so stormwater management is a bit tricky. Before Steve goes, the discussion you had a little bit with the berming, it'd be, you know, looking at a berm over there, you know, wiped out a whole, you know, whole site of parking. So,
yeah.
So the only thing you probably do maybe to, as additional buffer would be some type of high quality masonry type fence, you know, as we've done some of our other.
Or it could be an iron wrought type, you know, 6 foot that's more decorative that then you have bushes and stuff that's in front of that. I mean, similar to what they did over at the central garage. I mean, just something to aesthetically. I guess my other issue from a planning standpoint is, first of all, why this area? And two, if this development leg doesn't sustain itself, what happens to this building and area? We have an area that's a prime area, and from a planning standpoint, what happens to that area? What's going to be done with that building? Now, all of a sudden, we have an underutilized building again. And so I'm curious to know from a planning standpoint, what happens? I mean, because this isn't going to be used a tremendous amount. Because
let's park that particular issue
until
we get the developer.
All right, that's fine.
Talk about the vision, but some of the more technical process oriented things. Steve is up here to talk a little bit about stormwater.
The permeable pavement that they're proposing is over top of a very large open base aggregate to store water. The site will have to be designed to meet the 40% reduction of for total suspended solids to meet the water quality on the redevelopment area. Any additional impervious areas will have to meet the standard of the 80. They will have limited flood water or quantity control that they will have to do here because the site was mostly impervious beforehand. Some of the additional impervious will be required to meet the stormwater quantity runoff.
Steve, do you know what's underneath, what the ground underneath that is? Is it clay or is it sand or what? And do we know what environmental issues are underneath that site?
The consultant's engineer may be able to answer that a little better. I believe there's anywhere from 3 to 8 feet of industrial fill that spreads across the site, so it's not great material. The stormwater will need to be kept isolated from that material, is my understanding.
And do you know if there's clay underneath that the water wouldn't be able to drain into?
Again, the stormwater is not going to be allowed to come in contact with that industrial fill, so it's not going to be allowed to go out of that area.
So we aren't sure at this point how that's going to be addressed.
They're building basically an underground storage with open aggregate that will have interconnected or drain and pipe system with a reduced outfall pipe or outlet pipe so that the water can be stored in the underground.
Okay, so it's an underground tank to store excess water in the event of a 10, 20 year, whatever, 100 year storm, and that will drain out gradually?
To meet the city's water quantity runoff, only the area of new development or an additional increased impervious area will have to meet the runoff area. So they should be able to design that area to have enough volume to handle that, yes. And then the water quality can also be handled through that aggregate area because the suspended solids bind to the stone.
So since that was, so again, we've run into that same issue. Since they're not adding impervious, they don't really need to deal with the water except for the area that becomes non-impervious again.
Correct.
So we still have a problem with water in that, potentially have a problem with water in that area.
The
because we're not improving it other than what they're creating.
On their site, yes, the city does have, we have run a stormwater analysis of the area. We had that done a few years ago. Currently, South Park has parallel, or has an 18-inch outfall, I believe, and it needs to go to a 48-inch outfall to put out there. And then the area of 14th, which is potential, has a dual, has a single 48-inch outfall that needs to go to a 72-inch. So the storm sewer in the area is drastically undersized from what it needs to be to meet the needs of the area. And as part of the street reconstruction improvements in that area, we're looking to install those improvements to handle that capacity.
And when's that plan, Steve?
Some of that work is going to have to happen concurrently with the arena. I don't think we want traffic using 11th Street or South Park in its current condition.
Right. All right, so this, so the city is going, if this moves forward, is going to have to reevaluate some of the street and sewer projects that we have planned for the next year or two.
I believe there's a, be looking at a TIF district potentially, or a TID district to help with that.
All right, thanks, Steve.
Other technical questions? Kathy.
Concerned about traffic movements up on 11th. What conflict would there be with the businesses north, on the north side of 11th?
I think primarily the basketball events would be taking.
Yeah, the basketball at that point.
Based on the timing of, you know, when these events are, I don't think we thought that there was going to be any traffic flow issues along 11th that were going to impact access. Or Jim Collins is here. Jim, would you have any comments on that?
When he's ready, he can come up and address that.
David.
I have a couple questions, but one related to this. What is the scope of the traffic impact statement? What is it going to look at? What is it going to try to address?
Well, I think we're going to look at it. Are there any improvements above the street light situation? Because we're proposing additional street lights or an upgrade to the street lights as part of this. And if there's any other things.
Well, what we're looking at, and Steve can help me as well if
Collins,
he wants. I'm Jim Collins, our transportation director. But what we looked at for traffic is upgrading the signals at South Park and South Main, as well as adding additional signals at 11th and South Main. Currently, they're proposing their main entrances be off of 11th. So we're looking at, with the traffic impact analysis, what we would like to kind of look at is the traffic, expected traffic flow in and out, and that would also address Kathy's question about if the businesses on the north, if they would be impacted or not. I'm not real familiar with their operation, but like Darren had said, I assume that most of their activities are during the day, and this would be more of evening activities. So we kind of want to look at the traffic flow patterns in and out and just make sure that adding the signal at 11th and upgrading the signal at South Park, that we have ensure that traffic still flows smoothly in and out, and we don't cause any queuing issues or backup, especially in South Main, mostly concerned with left turning movements in and out of that site. And then additionally, like you had already talked about the parking situation, I guess right now we would be looking to take that through the traffic review board for advisement, but we're currently thinking that parking obviously wouldn't be allowed east of South Main on 11th or South Park. The neighborhood right now, 12th is 37 feet wide, so it is, per our current warrants, it's wide enough to allow parking on both sides and still allow two-way traffic. So I don't see it as a lot different from some of the issues we have around where other events are in the city. You know, we have other areas obviously by the university and the high schools where, you know, there's more on-street parking when events happen. But those are things we could look at as well. But we kind of had our initial thoughts on what the traffic patterns and flows would be, but we'd be looking for the traffic impact analysis to either help us with any modifications to that or to confirm what our thoughts are.
Just a follow-up, is there a standard that you follow to do a traffic impact? Is there a you know, ASTM standard or the equivalent that you know, you have to check the boxes? Because
WSDOT has a standard for
it. We currently, as a city, we don't currently have anything that we look for, but generally, since we have a limited staff, what we would be looking for is the developer would hire a consulting firm that does those types of things. And I don't know, Steve, if you know if there's any standard that they use or.
I thought WSDOT had a standard. Was it WSDOT? WSDOT does have a standard that you go over.
I believe we use it as well, because WSDOT requires some of those with major developments along their state highways, and so I believe there's a procedural setup there if we needed to.
All right, I was just concerned about the thoroughness, and I'm not sure if even some of your impressions are correct already. So you're, you know, the level of detail and drilling down about the traffic impacts in the neighborhood may not be correct.
Well, from a traffic impact analysis, you know, what they're mainly going to be looking at is traffic flow in and out of the site. The parking's going to be a separate issue, but yeah, I mean,
there's other traffic interactions in the area.
Sure. Yep, and that's something they would be looking at.
That was what I wanted to follow up with. I mean, I don't want necessarily your traffic impact study just to look at, you know, Main Street 12th and 11th, because of now the idea that there's going to be up to, you know, several hundred cars parked in neighborhoods, and when they all let out at the same time, you know, those feeder neighborhoods are feeding those main streets, that the impact study actually look at a little bit broader point to David's point on what that impact is on those neighborhoods when, you know, everybody lets out at the same time, and we've only looked at what's going to happen on Main and South Park. Well, you've got all these other smaller residential areas that now may have, you know, dozens and dozens of cars backed up waiting to turn where there may not be stoplights and just, you know, stop signs. And so I'd like to see you guys look at the broader picture.
Sure.
It may not have any impact, but, you know, I'd rather see that.
As a model, Alberta Kimball has more than 25 events where they fill that place up and they figure out a way to make, it work. But John.
And just one thing to follow up on, and hopefully we're capping this discussion on parking off here, but if they're going to charge for parking, you're going to see the neighborhoods see a lot more parking. And that's one of the things that I hope they make sure they take into account in their review. Just putting that out there, it's easy to overlook something like that, because even if they charge only $5 for parking, people are going to save their money and park on 14th and South Park and 11th and 12th. So,
yeah, I agree. There's definitely going to be an impact.
Other technical questions, David?
When you did the unimproved site plan, you had two blue parcels and then this yellow parcel. Can you explain those, please, and how they, what these all mean?
The two blue parcels are the Buckstaff.
Are the Buckstaff, existing
Buckstaff parcels. The yellow parcel is the Canadian National parcel. So that's included for, if we're, you know, as we move forward with more planning in the area. Our idea potentially is South Park could actually continue to move to the east, and potentially there could be a ring road around this entire development. So that's kind of why we included it
right here. There's nothing proposed on it right now, but our thought is there could be a ring road surveying a broader development. Thank you.
Right away for that ring road, as that is drawn.
There'll be some challenges along the way, but
it gets pretty close up there.
It does
up
get
on
tight
on the northeast.
We haven't
side.
Engineered it out yet, so but that is where the next step would be. We can take that concept and put it into pen and paper.
Any other technical questions? Okay, seeing none. Anyone here to speak to this item today? Let us know what you think. Come on up, ma'am.
Judy Williams, and I'm here on behalf of Al Rosedale. And I think maybe a little of what David was referring to with the traffic on 11th Street. Currently, we run 24 hours a day back there, and our semis run on 11th Street all night long. Now, I'm not opposing anything because we are actually in the process of relocating Al Rosedale, but I don't know what the timeline for this is, and I think that there's going to be some overlap between the development of this project and our leaving the area that we're in right now. So that's just something that we really need to consider. The other thing with the semis, I just worry about the safety of, you know, having a bar down there or whatever while we're still having you know, the entrance being off 11th Street. Am I correct on that?
During the off season or during the non-game nights, the main entrance will be off of South Main.
Will be off of South Park.
Or South Main.
South Main.
But then during the games, and what time do those games usually run, or you don't have a clue, or at this point, I don't know.
We're gonna, the developers here can respond. We can get an answer to that one.
Okay.
Our assumption is it'd be similar to the NBA, where it would be at
7 to 10.
Which we have trucks coming in all night long. But, and that's, it's something that I just want everyone to be aware of, not that we're opposed to the project, or that we don't want to work together trying to figure something out, but we still have to run our operation while this goes on. So, and then my one other question that I don't think came up is snow removal. And that's only, I'm just speaking from years of experience living right down in that area. Now I know 11th is going to be wider, but you still have property to the north, and then you have your parking lot. So, are you just going to push the snow to the end of 11th Street, or what are you going to do to deal with snow removal on that street?
Thank you.
Okay.
Do you have an estimated time when you're planning on moving?
Right at this moment, I don't, because we're going through some of the permit processes for where we're looking to move to. But my guess is it's going to be probably a minimum of 18 months to 2 years before we'll be out of that area. So,
anyone else here to speak to this item today? Bless you.
Bless you.
Jason White, I live at 1204 Fairfax in Oshkosh. I also serve as the CEO of the Greater Oshkosh Economic Development Corporation. And first became familiar with this project actually almost a year ago. February 5th, was invited with several other people to join Greg and Pierce and Kim Molitor of Windward Well Strategies to talk about the possibility of vetting a possible proposal to the Milwaukee Bucks to attract a developmental league team to Oshkosh. And at that time, as part of that, decided also then to work with Greg and his team, Blue Door, and also to garner the interest of the community, which was received with a great amount of enthusiasm for the potential of Oshkosh being the home for the Milwaukee Bucks Developmental League team, which currently they do not have. One of the things I think Jeff had mentioned earlier, which was, how is the site determined? And as certainly as Greg will testify to, I'm sure, is that the site search for this location was very extensive and very exhaustive throughout our community, looking at sites up and down the I-41 corridor, looking at a variety of sites downtown, and actually in the submission to the Milwaukee Bucks, this site was certainly one of them, but also a site along I-41 as well. This site has always been a site that was really been targeted for a project that has a lot of meaning for the community, certainly once the blight of Buck staff was removed. In the end, once it was determined that a timeline could be constructed for this project to meet the timeline for the Buckstaff property, then it was determined that the Buckstaff site would be the perfect site, given that this site really, this project really deserves to be downtown. If you look at, for example, what the Milwaukee Bucks have done, and no announcement has yet been made, but if you look at what they've done downtown in Milwaukee, they're an organization that certainly, and Greg can speak to this, has invested in the downtown areas where they are. So I think that this certainly is a good fit for the downtown, I think, for those reasons. Other sites were looked at also and also eliminated. Believe it or not, I-41 sites, Greenfield sites, are not, in some cases, as development-ready as you might think. For areas related to topography or wetland restrictions or whatnot, this site did not have those compared to some of the other sites considered. Has certainly their own set of barriers and challenges, but those issues weren't as prevalent. So given that there's a very tight time frame with this, didn't need another reason to make that a challenge. I do want to add a couple more things that may be of interest to folks is that, and some of you were there, it was last Wednesday, January 11th, we had a open house for, particularly for the neighborhood around this location. We invited, I think we sent out about 250 letters, residents from 10th to Nebraska to 14th to Maine. And we had approximately 100 folks show up that night to answer questions, interact with Greg and his team, and talk about the projects. Also, I know there's been weekly meetings with city staff and Bayland to keep everything on track, look at the timeline, adjust the timeline as necessary, not knowing whether we're looking at a 2017 season or a 2018 season, but certainly preparing for a 2017 season. I also want to mention, too, that this is an economic development angle, which obviously is my business. And that is, there's been a great effort in this community recently, in particular, to promote quality of life of Oshkosh, to bring more people here to our community. And recently, we had the opportunity to interact with a state workforce economist who didn't want to be quoted on the record with this, but did say off the record that he really believes that our unemployment rate could fall as low as 2.5% over the next couple of years, especially as Oshkosh Corporation continues to grow. So job growth in our community is a good thing. Labor constraints from the eyes of our employers is a challenging issue. So continuing to look at ways that we can bring more people to our community as Event City, promoting the quality of life is certainly very important. And this project certainly stacks up with that. Certainly helps other projects that could potentially come down the line, like the Pioneer, other mixed use opportunities for that area. So. From our perspective, certainly would hope that the Planning Commission offers your vote of support this evening.
Anyone else here to speak to this item today?
Gary Davies. I have the building across the street, the restaurant. And I guess my idea is that from what I hear, you guys were talking 3 stoplights, South Park, 11th and 9th Street. Stoplights on 11th Street. Okay, just so that the traffic will move around and there's no. And then the other thing, years ago, I had an issue with parking on the street right near the building. And I think we got it moved to 90 minute or 2 hour parking. Is that gonna be what it's gonna be so that somebody isn't there for 4 or 5 hours in front of the restaurant or?
Well, at this point, we're not. That would be under the purview of the traffic review board, but we're not proposing any changes to the parking situation, which is what.
I just when I was down at last week's meeting, I just saw some spots were 4 hour parking, some were 2 hour parking.
And that was the existing. That's the existing situation right now.
Thank you, Mr. Davies. Anyone else here to speak to this item today?
And good afternoon. I'm Greg Pierce. I'm the president and CEO of Windward Well Strategies and of Fox Valley Pro Basketball. We're the developer on the project. I'm going to answer some questions that came up, and then I'll go wherever we want to go. I think, John, your question on parking, you're right on. This hit me about 3 weeks ago, which was exactly that. If we charge for parking, which in the plan is we are we going to have people parked all over the neighborhood? And the answer would be yes. So here's the way we're approaching that. Our goal is like a lot of things, to get a sponsor to be the sponsor to provide parking to all events for free for an entire year, and look to have a sponsor to do that. If we can do that, it's revenue neutral to me. Our goal is to fill that parking lot up. We want to minimize the impact on the neighborhood for that. We're also looking at other spots we can acquire property to get more parking. We've maximized the parking that we can get on the site. The CN property, as an example, could give us a little bit more parking if we can acquire it. We're in the middle of trying to do that. And as the development moves, we would hope to gain more access to parking. So 580 is where we're at. I would hope we can get closer to 700 as we continue to work through the process. So we have thought about the same thing, and we're going to try to solve that. Because you're right, if we charge for $5, half people are going to park on the street, and we want to minimize that. So I wanted to address that. Was there other questions I should address right away? There was one other one. I forgot what it was. Oh, I think on all row, you had asked about game time. Game time typically is going to be between 7 and 7:30. You will find over half the dates, the plan would be 24 home dates. Over half those would occur on a Friday or Saturday. So, and normally in the evening, you could have a day game. The only day game possibility would probably be on a Sunday. And then the other games would be intermittently dispersed between mostly Tuesdays and Thursdays. So beyond that, then we are planning a lot of other events that we can talk about. But, I mean, the biggest impact with the largest attendance consistently would be professional basketball.
And what's the plan for this development, this building, if the development league doesn't continue on?
Good question. Because we're privately paying for this, this is going to be, we're raising net $25 million. This building's going to cost us $15 million plus infrastructure improvements of about $4 million. We have a lot on the line, so that isn't going to happen. One, we have a long-term lease with the Bucks, once we get through all the stuff there. I mean, so again, we're not going to build this building without some kind of assurances for time. Unlike prior basketball operations, the D-League here in this case, the teams are owned by the NBA. So these are deep pocket people. We're not going to be scraping by day to day, for survival like prior minor league basketball was doing. We do have a longer term lease. And then because of the scope and size of the building, we actually believe we can operate this as an entertainment venue without professional sports and still be able to make a go of it. And we also plan on attracting trade shows, conventions, and youth sports. The building is laid out, if you look at the plans, for one court that would seat 3,500, but that seating is movable, that we can pull it out and we can create three basketball courts on there that we can use for the community or for tournaments. So the building is truly multi-use. Now, would we build a building without a professional sports contract? Probably not. But with it, it gives us the foundation to build the building and then provide everything else we're going to be able to do. The net impact then is, again, the operation of this building at a $15 million cost is actually extraordinarily reasonable. And my break even is low enough that I think on entertainment things or youth tournaments, we can make a go of it even without that. If you're familiar, there's a youth sports facility in Wisconsin Dells that is similar in size. They don't have the seating capacity, but they have the size of it, and they operate solely on youth sports. So we believe with everything we have going, that should not be a problem, and we've got too much on the line to let that go. So again, that the arena and the building of that is separate from basketball. The basketball would just be a tenant in the building.
Other questions for the petitioners on this here?
Yeah, Craig, we've talked about this a little bit, and Jason got into it a little bit. Why do you like this location for this particular operation?
I think that this can be the beginning of a significant movement and redevelopment for this community. You see this throughout the nation in terms of what sports does for redevelopment. I know people have thought this is a basketball deal. This isn't a basketball deal. This is a redevelopment deal. The basketball is going to help spur. So if you look at what our plan is longer term, this is just the beginning of that. We have more plans that would go and extend as we get the Sawdust District up and underway. This is kind of the first phase of that. And we plan on doing a lot more in the area in terms of what could be an entertainment district with more things to do in the area, along with possibly office space and other things. We've also been working with, and I'm not going to speak for Mr. Dumke, but we have been working with Art to try to make sure the Pioneer Project goes. And our project, I certainly, and we'll let Art talk to that, but I think Art, if we get going in that, I think it does nothing but help him get that underway too. So we believe this is the first step to further development that we're real excited about. So basketball is just going to be the beginning of that project. It will probably go on for the next 5 to 7 years.
Any other questions for the petitioner? Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else here to speak to this item today? All right, seeing none, the public commentary is closed. Back to the commission. Go ahead, David.
One, I'd like to speak in outright support of this. I think that some of the hanging questions can be answered as the development plans go forward and are brought to staff or back here. I think the important thing is that this would be the anchor on South Main Street. I think it was Jason mentioned in a little different way, it's terribly important that we make our community relevant. Why are people going to want to come here? We see that the state of Wisconsin has problems attracting people, staying population neutral. So we're going to have to make our city and our community as attractive as possible, and this certainly will be part of it. The others, I think that allows us to shrink the city, to reinvest in the residential areas that we have there, plus additional commerce and recreational development. I've had, because of business, been in Lincoln, Nebraska for many years, and seeing what happened when they built the arena downtown. And the scale may be different, but the development that it engendered, whether it was entertainment or housing or food and beverage, is just amazing. And it took a old derelict railroad and warehousing area and has revitalized that whole area of Lincoln, Nebraska, and can be a model of what can happen here.
Jeffrey.
And I agree with David and the developer. I mean, I come from, and Jason, as far as quality of life issues. I know, my company is based in Ripon. It's a sizable company. We have a tremendous problem trying to recruit talent here, mainly because they just don't see the quality of life issues. And something like this can help that. To where, because it's a fairly easy commute. A lot of the management people elect to live in Oshkosh and commute to Ripon. So those things are favorable from what I'm looking at it from a development standpoint, to be able to attract people. Having also done that for our company and looked at different sites, we evaluate that as far as the types of things. And I think that's becoming even more important as the millennials come into management and things. It's more important to them than maybe it was to me or my father. The other one that I look at, and I agree with David wholeheartedly, sports and bringing an anchor is important. I came from Indianapolis. Indianapolis used to be known as Naptown because essentially at 6 o'clock at night there wasn't a soul downtown, and they started to do that. They built a basketball arena down there, now they're on the second one. They built a football stadium down there, now they're on the second one. They moved the semi-pro baseball team downtown, and that has attracted hotels, that has attracted other businesses, things of that nature, restaurants and stuff all downtown. Now it's not downtown anymore. You go down there at on a Wednesday and you'll have 10,000 people downtown milling around because it's become a destination. And it's not just the sports, but like I said, there's conventions, there's all sorts of other things that were attracted, and we have that infrastructure here. We have the convention center. It's going to be down right down the street from it, the downtown hotel, and we have, this is to me just one more tool in the toolbox that we need to further develop the city. So although we don't know all the specifics at the moment as far as, you know, what it's going to look like, some of the contentious issues about, you know, water retention, things of that nature, I still think that the city staff and stuff are well averse, advised on that kind of stuff, that they're going to make it a something that will work in the city. I also think that, you know, the aesthetic appeal that they're going to do, you know, associated with the Bucks organization that do a pretty good job at what they do, you know, that they want to put forth a product, and this may be just a tenant there, but it's a major tenant, obviously, that they're going to make sure that this is a quality thing that they have, because it directly reflects on them. So I'd be in support of this moving forward.
Thank you very much. Other commentary?
Make a motion to approve with the recommendations and conditions as they are.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any other comments? Great. Let's take call the roll.
Weigert?
Aye.
Forsyth?
Aye.
Tomes?
Aye.
Hintz?
Aye.
Cummings?
Aye.
Kropp?
Aye.
Kiefer?
Aye.
Foytek?
Aye.
Motion carried 8-0.
Any items for us today, ladies, gentlemen?
Nope. Motion to adjourn.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
We're done.